Thank you, Honorable Speaker, sir, for giving this opportunity to speak in support of the Dam Safety 2019 Bill. At the very outset, I would like to congratulate the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi ji, for taking the special interest in trying to bring this bill, which is at a belated stage. And I must also congratulate Honorable Minister for Jal Shakti for effectively piloting this bill, whose conception in the first time is almost older than me. The first time the idea of bringing about a bill of this nature to protect the dams of this country was originated in the year 1982. Since then, there have been multiple efforts made to ensure a legislation is brought about which will ensure there is constant surveillance, inspection, monitoring of the safety of the numerous dams that are present in this country. Unfortunately, the legislation has not seen the light of day due to a host of reasons. And this particular attempt, I'm sure, will bear fruit, because this particular bill is brought about under the Article 246 of the Constitution of India, read with entry 56 and 91 of list 1. One of the principal challenges that have been thrown by the opposition to the government regarding the legislative competency of the bill is that the union government does not have legislative competence to legislate on matters regarding distribution of water. And because water is a state subject under list 2, the union government has no legislative competence to legislate so far as this is concerned. Briefly, I would like to allay the fears of the opposition by taking them through the primary provision through which we derive the legislative competence. The union government derives legislative competence to legislate on all matters under Article 246 of the Constitution of India. And the two entries of 56 and 91 very specifically lay out the powers of the union government. Let me kindly read out the specific provision, the entry 56 of list 1, which states that regulation and development of interstate rivers and river valleys, to the extent to which such regulation and development under the control of the union is declared by Parliament by law to be expedient in the public interest. Speaker, sir, one of the principal changes that has been brought about in this legislation, in its latest avatar, is the declaration of the expedient public interest, which clearly empowers the Parliament to legislate under entry 56. Also, the doctrine of pith and substance is not something that is foreign to Indian constitutional jurisprudence. I would just want to read one important observation that the Honorable Supreme Court had made in its Constitution Bench judgment, in the Ujagar Prince versus Union of India judgment, wherein it elucidated on how entries in the union list or the lists under the Constitution must be read. In para 48, the Honorable Supreme Court exposes that entries to the legislative lists are not sources of the legislative power, but are merely topics or fields of legislation and must receive a liberal construction inspired by a broad and generous spirit and not in a narrow and pedantic sense. The expression "with respect to" in Article 46 brings in the doctrine of pith and substance in the understanding of the exertion of the legislative power. And whenever the question of legislative competence is raised, the test is whether the legislation, looked at as a whole, is substantially with respect to the particular topic of the legislation. Therefore, if a cursory reading of the legislation and its provisions are made, one can certainly ascertain that the pith and substance of the legislation is primarily to overlook maintenance, surveillance and the safety of the dams and has nothing absolutely whatsoever in controlling the ownership, the controlling of the water or any other such ancillary subjects with which the opposition may have any fears over. There is not a single provision in the bill which can be construed as something that makes an assault on the federal structure of the constitution, something that has been repeatedly bandied about by the opposition. I would like to just point out two specific issues in as briefly as possible as to why a bill of this nature is imperative in today's times. In 2017, the CAG conducted a report of how many states had conducted regular inspections of the dams in their jurisdictions before and after the monsoons. To the surprise and dismay of this house, we may learn that in 2017, the CAG report brought to light that only two states, one was Tamil Nadu, West Bengal, and one was Tamil Nadu, only two states out of the 17 which were audited conducted a pre-monsoon and post-monsoon audit on the safety of its dams. Therefore, the issue of dam safety, ensuring there is perpetual surveillance, continuous monitoring of the quality of dams, is something that needs to be given a statutory status. And the other most important thing that this bill envisions is that as a country, we are moving towards forming a national protocol on and standardizing the measures that are required to address issues of dam safety. In 2002, the World Bank came out with a report wherein it made a study, a comparative and a contrasting study of various dam safety legislations across 22 different countries in the world. I think Honorable Member Sri A. Raja made a reference, passing reference to this report. But one critical input in the report, or rather takeaway or a suggestion of the report, is that in all important countries, whether it is the United States or whether it is Russia or whether it is Canada, most of the dam safety regulations are made at the federal level. And it must be kept in mind that India is a union of states, unlike the United States, which is a federation of states. And therefore, the union government in India has far more legislative power to legislate for the whole country than in other countries like the United States and Australia. However, by his own admission, in the United States today, there is a federal law which governs this field, and dam safety regulation is governed by laws which apply for the whole of the United States, and therefore India must also make efforts to legislate at the national level for all states. Lastly, sir, I would just want to bring two points which I think are very important, which are very novel, which the bill brings about. As on today, the Committee on Dam Safety issues a lot of advisories, issues a lot of guidelines to many state governments. But because there is no penal provision, these guidelines cannot be ensured, cannot be enforced in a strong manner. Under this bill, there is penal provisions which will enforce the guidelines of the National Dam Safety Authority as well as the state authority. Lastly, sir, the different committees which have been envisioned, whether it is the Committee on Dam Safety, the Dam Safety Authority, the State Committee and the State Dam Safety Authority, all of them will work in a partnership to ensure only one particular objective is taken care of. That objective is regarding the safety of our dams. There is only one particular request that I have with the Honorable Minister. Though this is a well thought out legislation, in my humble opinion, the legislation, so I'll just conclude in a minute, the legislation does not fix accountability if there is a failure of a particular dam. It envisions provisions which will deal with failures of dams. It has penal provisions which deal with how, in the case of any guideline or direction which is not implemented, what will be the penal consequences that follow. However, sir, I'll conclude in 30 seconds. However, this bill will be a more comprehensive legislation if provisions to fix accountability of errant officials or errant owners of the dams and consequent penal provisions are also incorporated in this bill. I congratulate the Honorable Government and also the
Shri Suresh
Pujari for having brought this bill, and I support it wholeheartedly. Thank you so much for this opportunity.